exciting thing going on with the United States military right now. And you have to pardon my voice, because I spent most of last week outdoors, and now I'm being advised. But, soldiers are returning to Christianity in droves. Those military preachers, what are they called? Chaplains. I don't know why I forgot that word, but it just left my brain. A chaplain reported in a military newspaper that since Korea and Vietnam, which he served in, and now he's been to Desert Storm, and now he's over in Afghanistan, said he's never seen such a reaction to the gospel as he's seen these days. In fact, if you go to a website called shieldoffaith.com, you can buy a little shield of faith to give to a soldier to carry in their pocket. And on the front of it, it has a symbol of the American flag, and on the back of it, it has Joshua 1:9. It says, "Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Do not be terrified and do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." And today, our troops are everywhere. As we gather together today with friends and family to celebrate the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ, it's important to remember the men and women of our armed forces serving in countries far from the comforts of home that we enjoy. At this very moment, as we're sitting here, there's American warriors laying their life and limb on the line to secure the freedoms that we enjoy, to worship, and just to move about in public without having to worry about being blown up as they do over there. Just walking to the store can be a life and death situation. I want to read a couple of letters written by American servicemen from different theaters of war. From World War II, one soldier writes to his brother the day after he landed in Anzio. Says, "Take a combination of fear, anger, hunger, thirst, exhaustion, disgust, loneliness, homesickness. Wrap all that up in one reaction, and you might approach the feelings that a fellow has. It makes you feel small, helpless, and alone. Without faith, I don't see how anyone could stand this." In 1969, a soldier wrote this letter to his mother. Remember when we were kids on Easter? The girls would be all dressed up in new hats and pretty dresses, and us boys with new shoes and shirts, off to church we would go, and afterwards we'd come home to look for our Easter baskets. Those were good times. I hope God will bring me back home so that I can marry the girl I love, which will be in March if things go okay. Then I can watch my kids get all dressed up and head for church and live that day over again. Holidays are no different than any other day here. Every day is mundane in Vietnam. And finally, one last letter written from Korea in late 1951. "I'm coming home. It's official as of this morning. That little house is going to look like a palace to me. Is it true that some people eat three times a day or more? And they sit on a chair by a table? What's the matter with them? Can't they dig a hole in the backyard like everybody else? There were times I would have traded my soul for a drink of cold water or a cup of hot coffee. But I'm coming home now. My brother isn't. He's listed MIA. If he's on this side of the line, I hope he makes it. If he's on the other side, I hope he's dead. He'd wish the same for me. I'm going to tell you now, you'll need a lot of patience with me. Patience and understanding. We all will." That's what we need to have for our troops overseas. Three different letters from three different people in three different wars, yet they all share a common thread: faith and a desire to be with family again. They look for the day when they can return home and once again enjoy the freedoms that they fight so hard to secure. To the people in this room who have served your country in the armed forces, thank you. You've come closer to experiencing the mission of Jesus Christ than most people ever will. When Jesus came to earth, it was a blatant act of war. He came to bring relief from the oppressive forces of evil. And to accomplish this mission, Jesus took on death itself and arose in glorious victory so that we can live in true freedom, the freedom of salvation. If you would, I'd like to stand, I'd like to have you stand, if you would, and join me as I lift up a prayer of protection and blessing for the service members doing battle right now with the forces of oppression from this earth, so that other nations around the world can enjoy their freedoms as we enjoy our own. Lord Jesus, as our brave troops step upon this battlefield, I pray that you would go at their side, be their comfort in times of sadness, be their companion in times of loneliness, be their champion in times of conflict. Protect them from the raging storm as they charge into its midst, and bless them with courage, boldness, and wisdom as they protect the weak from anyone that would do harm. And bring them home again to those that they love and fight for. In the name of the mighty conqueror and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you.
Give their ultimate sacrifice. You know, Jesus Christ did too.
Yes,
he was the one that started. Santa Claus and little Marine. A Marine here had a little poem. This Marine wrote this poem. He talked about Santa Claus and the Marine in the seas. It says, 'twas the night before Christmas. He lived all alone in a one-bedroom house by the plaster of stone. I had come down the chimney with presents to give to see just who in this home they lived. I looked all about, a strange sight I didn't see. No tinsel, no presents, not even a tree. No stocking but mantle, just boots filled with sand. On the wall were hung pictures of far distant land. With medals and badges and awards of all kinds, a sober thought came through my mind. Well, this house was different. It was dark and dreary. I found the home of a soldier once I could see clearly. The soldier lay sleeping and silent, alone, curled up on the floor in this one-bedroom home. His face was so gentle. The room was in such disorder, not how pictured the United States soldier. Was this hero whom I had just read curled up on a poncho, the floor of a bed?
No.
I realized the families that I saw last night owed their lives to these soldiers who were willing to fight. Soon around the world, the children will play, all grown-ups will celebrate a bright Christmas day. They all enjoyed freedom each month of the year because of the soldiers like the one lying here. I couldn't help but wonder how many lay alone on Christmas Eve in a land far from home. The very thought brought a tear to my eye. I dropped to my knees and started to cry. The soldier awakened, and I heard a rough voice, "Santa, don't cry. There's life in my souls. I fight for freedom. I don't ask for war. My God and my life is what I wrote with my country court. The soldier rolled over and drifted back to sleep. I couldn't control it. I wanted to weep. I kept watch for hours from silent still, and we both shivered from the night's chill. I didn't want to leave on that cold dark night this guardian army so willing to fight. The soldier rolled over with a voice soft and fury, whispered, "Carry on, Santa. It's Christmas Day and all is secure." One look at my watch, I knew he was right. Merry Christmas, my friend. To you all, a good night.
Thank you. and welcome to the Children's Church program. Listen with us as the children tell the meaning of the gifts given to Jesus and the candy cane story.
There is a special meaning behind each of the gifts the Magi brought.
Gold was a sought-after treasure. The king of the Medes sent a most appropriate gift to honor the newborn king.
Frankincense was a sacred perfume used by the Jewish priests as an offering of purity. How appropriate to bring it to the one who would always live a pure and holy life.
Myrrh was a costly spice used to prepare a body for burial. At first, it seemed like an unusual gift to bring to a newborn babe. But somehow the Magi understood that the God, the Son of God, must exchange the glory of heaven not only for the loneliness of a stable, but also the humility of a girl.
The meaning of the gifts is this: gold for the King of Kings, frankincense for a sinless life, myrrh for the one who would rather die than live without him in heaven.
The red stripes remind us of Christ's death on the cross.
The curtain at the top looks like a shepherd's staff and helps us that remember that shepherds were the first to hear about our Savior's birth.
Turned upside down, the candy cane looks like the letter J, symbolizing the first letter in Jesus' name.
Is there room in your heart? More than 2,000 years ago, Joseph and Mary knocked at the door of an overcrowded inn and were told,
"No room."
Today, Jesus knocks softly at the door of our overcrowded hearts. With all the excitement and joy of making this a Christmas to remember, let us promise ourselves to find room for the one whose birth we celebrate. And thank you for giving us your time. This is Faith Alive Children's Church.
Kids really make Christmas special, don't they? And since I don't usually get a chance to say it, I do want to really say a special thanks to April Trogdon for her work with Children's Church. It's important for the children to have a church and learn the things that they learn, and I really appreciate the work that April does. And since when she's doing all that hard work she does for the church, she has to ignore her husband Gary. I want to thank him too for putting up with that. He's a good man. The unfortunate thing about Christmas has been mentioned a few times today is that, and it's really every Christmas, I don't think I remember a Christmas that we didn't have soldiers somewhere, soldiers, sailors, airmen, somewhere in the world defending democracy and freedom. And the poem I chose this morning was written by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, and I didn't know this till I was looking at this poem. It's called Christmas Bells. He wrote it in 1864, and for you good history students, you know that that was during the Civil War, and he wrote this poem. It later became a Christmas carol when a man named Calkin he removed three of the verses and made it into a Christmas carol, so you may recognize some of the words as I'm reading it. But this was written by Henry Longfellow, and it was written on Christmas Eve in 1864, 150 years ago. And the occasion was that as he was reflecting on Christmas there was a knock at his door, and a government official came to tell him that his son had died in a battle, one of the battles of the Civil War. And so later that evening, he wrote these words. I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play, and sweet and wild the words repeat of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And thought how, as the day had come, the belfries of all Christendom had rolled along the unbroken song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Till ringing, singing on its way, the world revolved from night to day, a voice, a chime, a chant sublime of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Then from each black, accursed mouth, the cannon thundered in the south. And with the sound, the carols drowned of peace on earth, goodwill to men. It was as if an earthquake rent the hearthstones of a continent and made forlorn the houses born of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And in despair, I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said. For hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead. God does not sleep. The wrong shall fail. The right prevail. With peace on earth, goodwill to men.
We've been practicing something very special, haven't we? And Abby, you're holding my chain. And we have been practicing on colors. Now, would you watch me, okay? What's this first color? Can you tell me? What color is it? Good, light. Okay, light. Jesus is our life. Jesus, my life?
Yeah. And Jesus is our shepherd, and the Holy Spirit is like the staff.
He brings us back and we start to wonder, doesn't he? Okay, this is a shepherd's staff. Turn it around and what do you have? What letter is this, remember?
A J.
J. And what does J stand for?
I know, Jesus.
Jesus. Now look at the colors. What colors are on this candy cane?
Red.
Red and white. White stands for a pure
heart,
and red stands for the
what?
Blood of Jesus. That's good. Okay, we have one more. That's okay. We have one more picture, okay? What is this picture right here?
Candy cane.
No, it's not here.
Candle.
A candle. And the candle reminds us once more of what? Of being a
candle.
Light. To the world. Okay. Can you also get your second? Get on your knees. You ready? Close your eyes. Remember when we pray, we always close our eyes and bow our heads. Father, we ask that you help us to be lights to the world. We ask that you help us to remember the true meaning of Christmas when we look at the shapes and the colors of Christmas, Lord. Help us to tell our families and friends, and help us to just be joyful and happy at this time. Help us, Lord, to celebrate your birth and the good news that you have brought to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. That's good. Here's another candy cane.
From the missionaries around the world. I'm the missions director, and I want you to look at this map and look at our missionaries that's around the world. And while you're looking at the map, we have seven doing the church at this month. We have two in South Africa, who is Roger and Mary Gorman, Ron and Linda Fripp. In Zambia, we have Andy Davison and family. France, we have Marty Delman. Holland, we have Matt and Femke Helman. India, we have Herbert and Marguerite Howard. And then we have Mike and Laura Reed in Uganda. I got an email from Mike one day this week, and he was here, and he said, this was the next day after he was here, they're getting ready to leave the 9th of January. Mrs. Mary, it was great to be in service with you all yesterday. Glory and I thank God for Faith Alive Church, and we cannot express how much you mean to us. We feel very honored and humbled to be Faith Alive missionaries to Uganda. Thank you and the church for your love and support. We love you all very much, from the missionaries to Uganda, Mike and Lori Reed. Then I got this one, the 7th. Mrs. Mary, thank you for your email about Christmas in Uganda. Although Lori and I have never spent a Christmas there as of yet, we will be leaving for Uganda January the 9th. I have talked to our pastors, and many of them meet on Christmas Day and have church, fellowshipping with one another, and thanks God for his precious gift for Jesus Christ. I sometimes am ashamed because in all our blessings are taking Christ on Christmas and them with nothing or worship him on Christmas. For the most of them, they do not have finances to do anything too elaborate for Christmas. But in times past, we have sent money for them to buy gold and have a meal at the church or some of the different holidays. I hope this helps somehow, and if you have any questions, please feel free to call me back. God bless you all, and do have a very Merry Christmas. Your missionaries to Uganda. And I feel like Lori and Mike are so special to this church. And I said, I feel like he's my son. So when I get an email from him, it just tickles me to death. So we need to pray for our missionaries around the world. And I'll be back the 5th of March, and this is when we have our World Missions Commitment Sunday, so we're putting some money back and make some commitments, because these people have given up their time to serve God, And they're not home for their, with their families for Christmas. So they're all over the world doing what God wants them to go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature. So be in prayer for all of our missionaries this Christmas. And remember the 5th of March when we can help them a little bit with their finances. Thank you from the missionaries around the world.
I'm going to read a poem that my aunt, with my mother's sister, wrote. And I have quite a collection of them. But this one was the one that I chose for Christmas. Signs of our times. Once again, as every year, we bring you news of Christmas cheer. Shining ornaments, wrapping bright, snow, icicles, lit up night. Trees with cotton, balls and lights, people looking at beautiful sights. Sleighs and sleds, skates and boats, cheers and parades, bands and floats. Guns and holsters, trucks and cars, tractors and spaceships from Mars. Dolls and dishes, sets for tea, things to make a little girl happy. Little angels, sleepy heads, don't have to be told to go to bed. Happy little girls and boys, filling Christmas with cheer and joy. Christmas baking, mysterious smells, cookies shaped like stars and bells. Salads, dressing, turkey, ham, nuts and fruits and candied yams. Baking, shopping, decorating, wrapping gifts, anticipating. Crowded streets, stores and shops, walking, driving, starts and stops. Exchanging gifts, sure to get something sure that don't fit. Working, rushing, worrying ills. Change the diet to headache pills. Incidentally, Christmas morn marks the day that Christ was born.
Downtown. It's about a news reporter who's reporting live from downtown, and he's asking shoppers as they pass by what the true joy of Christmas is.
Hi, I'm Wally W. Wiglacker, WWW News. It is 2 days till Christmas, and we are looking for people who can experience their holiday cheer. People are passing by for that last Christmas spirit. The Christmas mood is bright as we see smile after smile. Excuse me, sir, would you mind sharing your holiday joy?
Huh?
Would you mind sharing your holiday joy?
Huh?
Would you mind sharing your...
Huh?
Sir. Well, it seems that we have met one of the town's more colorful characters. But what is Christmas without a fruitcake? Ah, here comes a promising person. Ma'am, Wally W. Waywacker with WW News. Would you mind sharing your joy with our viewers?
You want me to have joy? Get real, Sonny. Give me some money. I'm trying to live on my sorry Social Security check and my sorry late husband's pension from a sorry job he had for 30 sorry years. And you know what he did for those 30 years, Sonny? He made faces all day.
Really?
He worked at a cook factory, and now here it is Christmas time, and I have 23 greedy grandkids who all want money. And I'm quite busted. And this is all I can buy myself for Christmas. In fact, this is my TV dinner. And you want me to have joy? Eat real.
Well, at least she's willing to share some of her dinner with me. It seems that finding the holiday spirit may be a little harder than I thought, but we'll keep looking. Let's see if we can snag someone overflowing with the merry mood of Christmas. Sir, would you mind sharing the Christmas, how it makes you feel?
Joy? Where? I don't have time for joy, you idiot. Don't you get it? I have brothers, sisters, aunts, uncles, cousins, in-laws, and outlaws at my house right now, and they all stink. They need gifts, food, and a bag. The plumbing at our house is... broke, and I'm trying to get everything we need,
and all the stores are sold out, and my therapist out of his office. the customers are out of control, and I'm out of my mind. Wake up, Jesus.
Christmas joy, it seems to be a rare commodity in the big city. But everywhere are lights, the snow is falling, and carolers can be heard. Well, it seems that we have the true symbol of Christmas, some carolers. Indeed, a heartwarming tradition that is seldom seen anymore. Let's listen for a moment.
And heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing.
Wonderful, just wonderful. In the day and age, it's great to see a group of people set aside their own busy schedules to help others. As I was saying, the sound of the season is a great backdrop to find the joy of Christmas. To find the joy of Christmas, we speak to passers by. Ma'am, would you mind sharing with us?
I can't hear you.
Would you mind sharing your holiday joy?
Help me find the little boy?
No, would you mind sharing your holiday cheer?
You say my hair looks like a horse's hair. Well, I never. Hi, Mom.
Well, let's see if we can get the carriers to donate their money to the poor this season. Man, and I thought he was going to start singing the 12 Days of Christmas next. Oh, goodness. Well, the Christmas joy is definitely hard to see, but surely we will find somebody with that holiday joy. Excuse me, do you have the holiday spirit?
Jack Frost roasting on an open fire. Chestnut sniffing at your nose. Yeah, I have the joys of Christmas right here, and they help me through this stupid time of year. Because nobody wants a stinky, smelly dummy like me. You know how long it's been since I've gotten a present? Well, no, it makes me sick. And look at this coated tongue.
Oh, God, it's
I only have a sliver of a liver left. I'm so sick, I have diseases, I'm so sick, I have so many ulcers, my stomach looks like Swiss cheese. And I have halitosis. No, halitofish. No, bad breath.
Oh, yes.
When I'm sick, I drink. And when I drink, I get sicker. And when I get sicker, I get drunker. And when I get drunker, I get sicker.
I know what you mean. I'm starting to feel sick myself.
Here, you can use a swig of this. Oh, sorry about that. Oh, I'm feeling sick now. Oh, a little bit better. Oh.
Well, there's nothing that can keep his Christmas spirits down. It seems that this city needs a visit from the spirit of Christmas past, because the Christmas present has been shoplifted. Let's try one more time. Excuse me, ma'am, would you mind sharing with us your holiday joy?
How dare you approach me with that idea of celebrating Christmas? That paid, commercialized excuse for running up credit card bills and worshiping at the false altar of Santa Claus and getting drunk. It smells like you had a swig yourself. It's evil! You're evil! Look at me. I don't participate in this heathen rite, and I have the true joy of the Lord.
Well, that goes to show you that.
Ho, ho, ho!
Oh, man. What in the world? These people are dead. What? Would you mind sharing your holiday joy?
I'll share it, but
let's
see what I can do for you first. Looks like you need a lot more help than I do. Let me help you with that. So what seems to be the problem?
I'm trying to do this news broadcast and people are just going crazy. They're hitting me with their phones, they're hitting me with their presents. And
well, here's your bet. Seems like you might have lost your holiday joy, my friend.
I don't understand why people celebrate Christmas if it's such a headache.
Because they've forgotten what it's all about. The angel said, Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy. but shall be unto all people, born to you, born this day in the city of David, a Savior, which is Christ the Lord.
You know, in all the rush, I tend to forget that sometimes.
So do others. That's why this isn't the present for some. They base their happiness on gifts and...
I think I understand. They celebrate the coming of Christ into the world, but they forget to ask them into their own hearts.
Yeah, you know, you're not that far from the kingdom of God. Let's go discuss this over at Pepper Pot Chocolate, my treat.
Well, there you have it. Finding the holiday spirit is difficult to do in the hustle and bustle, but maybe, just maybe, we're looking in the wrong places. Perhaps the key to the holiday hoax lies not in the gift of Macy's, but in the gift God gave us, wrapped up in a swaddling clothes in a manger. This is Wally W. Wigwacker reporting from downtown. Now back to the studios of WWTV.
This is TL4C, Teens Living for Christ, and their sponsors, their new sponsors.
The amount of goodies we ate was quite shocking. No one knew how St. Nick had got in while we dozed, for the doors were all locked and the chimney was closed. But we knew he'd been here, and he didn't need coal. And 12 hours later, all the thunder was told. The children were missing wherever they fell, and Mommy and Daddy were feeling quite swell. We had all survived the fine holiday season without losing our sanity for some unknown reason. The tree and the trimmings were still standing intact. All the gifts from the great aunts could all go back to the stores with kids reject mufflers and hats to trade for the perfect glove and or bat. Just 24 hours ago, we all swore we'd never re-enter another mall store. Not for any reason, while horses can't drag us back to those mobs we'd been heard to brag. But did you see what Aunt Ethel had sent? We can get something cool with the money she spent. The clothes were all so lame, said the kids in a twinkling, and I thought to myself, what on earth was she thinking? So we fell asleep on the couch floor or beds while visions of super sales danced in our heads. Most of the wonders we'd unwrapped were great, though some of the shopping was done rather late. Still, we loved all the toys and the tools and the dresses, but what I need now is some help with the messes. The den has been trashed, the living room's missing, the toddler just fell, and her owie needs kissing. The teenager's ear appears to be stuck to the phone, yet he's blasting the tape by some thugs he calls bone. The kitchen may need some paint and some plaster. The dinner was delicious, the stove's a disaster. There's not a clean plate, glass, or spoon to be found. I can't find the counter. My head's starting to pound. Quick, somebody open this childproof cap. Never mind, there's no water, I buried the tap. So as we bask in the holiday glow with all of our loved ones and friends that we know, I'll repeat this again and get it just right. Merry Christmas to all. And now, please, good night.
If you're here this morning, you look good. You may not feel good. You may not feel like that you're 100%. But if you're here this morning, you're good. You'd rather be here than any jail or any hospital. Amen. So this morning, God has given you a gift this morning in life that you're here. How awesome that gift is. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, I want you to just turn with me to Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6. I want to give you some things about Christmas. Tony, can you turn these lights and these lights off? I want to set a mood here today, if I can do that. The gifts of Christmas. You know, the youth portrayed everything that goes on in the world today. You see people at the mall. We were over there yesterday and last night, and people going to and fro, running crazy, trying to find those gifts for the right right person and the right gift for the right person. Do you know that you can give people whatever you can give them, and sometimes it's not the right thing? What you think may be right for somebody, sometimes isn't. But God knows us, and He knows exactly what to give us. And one of the things that you need to understand about Christmas is that God's Word is true. God's Word will always come about into what He's saying. And this morning I want to tell you one of the number one thing in this story was the prophecies about the Christ child. In Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6 it says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given." And if you really look at that, unto us a child is born. He's given us the child. God didn't just have Christ to come just so He could say, "I gave Him." He gave Him to us. It's a gift. The Christ child is actually the gift for us, for salvation, for redemption in our lives. See, a lot of times we have people that leave Him there in the manger because He's so innocent. And babies are that way. They have no sin about them. So they leave Christ in the manger. And some people leave Christ doing miracles. He's the God Almighty. He's the God-man. And they leave Christ there because He can supply all of my needs. And I'm needy. And I have lots of needs. The people that were portrayed here on this stage just a few minutes ago, all of them had different needs. Every one of them was angry about Christmas because their need was not met. And the reason that it wasn't met is because somebody didn't take the time to share Christ, the true Christ, with them. How awesome it is that whenever Christ comes, He comes in the humble manner, the lowly manner of us. He became like us so that He could deal with us on our level. How awesome that is. Left his lofty throne just to come down to be one of us. To feel the hurts and the pains that you go through every day. He knows what you need and what you have need of. And what I like about Him is He is the miracle worker. See, God's Word came through His Son. Jesus is the Word. It says, "In the beginning the Word was with God. And the Word was God." Amen. The Son actually means the lineage of the name will continue. How many of you are sons here today? Of somebody? How many of you have a son here today? Yeah. And what that means is your name's going to go on. If they have kids, their kids is going to continue your name. That's awesome. That's what God did with His Son. He said, "I'm sending you a child, a gift today to carry on my name in your world." That's awesome. That's awesome. If you have received Christ, then you are a true son of God. You are one that carries on the name and the lineage of God. How awesome a gift is that? That God thought enough of you to send His Son so that you can carry on His name. In this setting, we find that the name continues, and it is an everlasting and eternal name. It is an everlasting kingdom, the Bible says. It never will end. It has no end to it. Today, your life has no end to it. One day you will step off into eternity. You will either step off into heaven, or you will step off into hell. And I know that sounds crazy to preach at Christmas time, but that's just how it is. There's no middle ground. There's no wait, stop, I'll change. Whenever you step off into that, your destiny has been set. There's no second chance. Amen? The second thing that happens in this story is we find salvation and deliverance. And we find miracles in that name. In Luke chapter 1, verse 26, Mary talks about, or the angel talks to Mary about how she will deliver a child. And that child will deliver her. The song, "Mary, Did You Know," actually portrays that the best that I've ever heard. It says, "Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know that the thing that's inside of you is going to one day deliver you, is going to one day deliver the whole world? Do you know, Faith Alive, that the thing that is within you, and if you're here this morning and you know Christ as your Savior, the thing that you're carrying within you is here to deliver the world? If you will just deliver it and you will let the process take place where when the time is right, that you deliver what God has within you in ministry. You're going to see awesome things. I thought this morning that Sister April and the kids done such a wonderful job. I thought, you know, that's really neat. Ralph, you should be proud of your granddaughter. April, we're proud of you. You're doing an awesome job. TL4C, Frank and Tanya, that was awesome. That was awesome. Francis was sitting there, she says, you know, this is a pretty good play, isn't it? This is a pretty good program. I said, I guess. And we're just sitting there, and we're sitting on a fence. She's the hen, and I'm the rooster, and we're just sitting there just sticking our chest out. But see, we didn't have anything to do with it. All we did was put people in place and say, run with it. Go with it. Do what you can. My, what an awesome thing. What God gives us, and He says, run with it. Go and do what you can with what I'm giving you. How awesome it is if people will just get out of the fear factor of life and begin to believe in what He says about you is going to come to pass. And in Isaiah, the last line of Isaiah in chapter 9 and verse 7 says this, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. He's going to bring it about. His zeal, His word is going to bring about in you, if you will allow it to happen, the things that He's already said about you. God said, before you were born, I knew you. I put you together. Brother Mike Savage's favorite scripture, one of the favorite scriptures in there, it says, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. You know why? Because God put me together. If you don't like me, you don't blame me, you blame God. He's the one that did it. We find miracles in this story, the gift of miracles. It was a miracle that Mary was a virgin and she had a baby. I asked true and false questions the other day in our Wednesday night Bible study. I got tickled. I was sitting there a while ago, and as Sister Cindy had the little kindergarten class up here, I leaned over, and I probably shouldn't say this, but I'm going to anyway. I leaned over and I told Francis, I said, this reminds me of my Wednesday night Bible study class. Those kids go, hey, I know. I said that. Isn't it funny that God places within us humor? Because life can be too serious sometimes. And how awesome it is that He may have placed you or me in your life for humor. To help you along. Because nobody really needs to be alone at Christmas. I like the part that Cody played a while ago. He says, you know how long it's been since I've got a gift? I've never gotten a gift. And some people really feel that way at Christmas time. So what can we give this year for Christmas? I'm going to tell you, one of the things in this story that God has given to Mary was not only that we find miracles, that she delivered a child without even knowing a man. But one thing that God did in this was said by the angel, and this is a mighty statement. If you can ever get this in your spirit, you will find out that God really truly does love you. It says, Mary, you're highly favored of God. You're highly favored of God. I want you to know this morning, if you're sitting in here and you're hearing my voice, you are highly favored of God.
Yes, amen.
God has a blessing plan for your life.
Yes, amen.
If you would just seek for it and let Him do it. How awesome it is that great things are in store for you. My, what an awesome God we have. One of the last things in this story that we find is friendship. See, when you really get right down to it, we all want a friend, don't we? We want somebody that we can talk to. We want somebody that will be there no matter what. Christ is that friend. Today, if you don't know Christ, you're missing out on the best friend you've ever had. Today, if you've never received Christ, you don't really know what friendship is. You don't really know what love is. I mean, you have a taste of it, but you don't really know what it is. Once you step into that realm of godly love, and you get to see the true friendship of who He really is, man, what an awesome thing. It'll change your life forever. In 1 John chapter 3 and verse 14, it says, we know that we have passed from death into life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. Verse 16 says this, hereby perceive we the love of God because He laid down His life for us. And in the conclusion of that verse says this, and we are to lay down our lives for the brethren. I like that. Because see, that's what a true friend really does. They'll drop everything at the drop of a hat if you holler help. It's almost like the old cartoon Underdog. Remember that? Some of you older folks, remember that cartoon Underdog? He was a mom and a shoeshine boy. But whenever he heard the cry for help, he turned into Underdog, the fearless superhero. And how awesome that is. But sometimes if we have our ears tuned to the people in need help, we too can become the superhero that God wants us to be. Just simply by being a friend. My, what an awesome thing. That's just like God. In Proverbs 18:24 says, a man that hath friends must show himself friendly. If you ever want to be a friend to somebody, you've got to stick out your hand and say, hi, I'm glad to meet you. Hi, my name is Ella Still. How are you? I just want to be your friend. That's what I want to say to you today. Hi, my name is Elvin Still. My pastor Still, just plain Elvin Still. I happen to be the pastor of this church, and I want to be your friend today. But more than that, I want Jesus to be your friend. Because without him, our friendship don't mean much. See, I will let you down at some point in time. And really, honest God, truth, you'll let me down too. But God will never let you down. He may not do everything that you want him to do because you can't manipulate him, just like people can't manipulate you. But the awesome thing is, whenever you really need him, he is always there. He's always waiting just to come into your life. It says, a man must show himself friendly. And there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. Brother Glenn was talking about the brotherhood of the military a while ago, and Brother Fred was talking about the brotherhood of the military, and Sister Mary was bringing in the brotherhood of our missionaries that basically is our military that goes on the front lines to see people saved in other countries. How awesome this Christmas really is. Because see, this Christmas is a turning point in this church. This Christmas is a turning point. Looks good to see this many people here this morning. It does. You're an answer to prayer. But you know what? It's going to be even better when we have to have two services like this.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Christ sticks closer than a brother because he actually came down to the brotherhood of men to be just like you. So he knows you. He knows what you're about. And he knows what you're going through. If you would, I'd like you to stand with me for just a minute. You may be here this morning and you may make me stand. I wish you could shut up and just give me a chance to find Christ. If you're here that way this morning and you've never known Christ, all Christians, I want you to begin praying. You watch your kids. I mean, it don't matter how good or bad they do, you watch them. Isn't that funny that God does that's the same way? He pays attention to us and everything that we do. But I was watching her the other night and she was just up there and she was just singing her heart out. And I thought, God, thank you. Thank you for such a precious gift in my life. See, sometimes we take those precious things for granted, don't we? Those things that God has already given us, we take so for granted. But this year, I want to wish you all a Merry Christmas from our family to yours. And we want to do something that we've never done before. This is a first. Matter of fact, this is only about the third time we've ever done it. But we want to sing to you this morning. Is that okay? We want to sing you a song. So at this time, if Nancy will come and Francis will come, we're going to sing to you.
This is a rare treat. He asked me to say something. I really wanted to do this morning because of my father. And last Christmas was our first Christmas without my dad. And I had made a statement last year at this time to the congregation about how important legacy is in your life. And I've had the privilege this year of teaching in a new school. And Nancy has taken my class. And so far we haven't gotten any fights or anything. We've done very well. But she's been singing with my choir, and I've been teaching them about singing and things like that. And I thought this would please my father very much. But it wouldn't only please my earthly father, but I know it pleases my heavenly father. And I'm just thankful for the Lord. I'm thankful for what he means in our lives. And truly, what they have all portrayed today and all of their skits and in all the things they did, it's not about the gifts. It's not about the gifts. It's not about the amount of money that people spend on you. But it truly is about the birth of Christ. That's the most important thing. See, this week, this past Wednesday, we had a memorial service in our school for one of our young men who was a senior at school at Stillwell. And he was involved in an automobile accident, and it took his life. And we had his memorial service at our school on Wednesday afternoon. And it was such a sad, sad time. But one of the things I told my audience Thursday night in closing of our Christmas concert was this. You know, his life was cut short. He was only 18 years old. And his life was cut short. And sometimes during Christmas, we get really busy. We're so tied up with buying just that right thing for them to make sure they like it because we're scared they're not going to like something that we take time to buy them. Or we're so busy trying to get all of our meals ready, trying to get all the desserts just right, trying to make sure we have everything covered, trying to decorate our house where everything is just hung right where it needs to be, you know, trying to make sure this, that, and this, and that, and this, and that. And it's like I told him Thursday, I said, you know, I encouraged the audience that night, this Christmas, don't look at your decorations. Don't even look at your meal, but look at your family and be thankful. Be very thankful for those God has given you that is your family. And you know, as Christians, we are a family. We are the family of God, and we need to do the same thing. Look around this room today. Just look. This is your Christian family. These are people who love you. We need to be thankful. We do. But had it not been for his birth, there would have never been a crucifixion or resurrection. So we're going to sing a real simple song this morning. And it's one I think we've heard already today, but we're going to try it our style, see what we can do, and just minister to you about a wonderful baby that was born.
Away in a manger, no crib for us. Yes.
This year has truly been a different year for us as your pastor at Christmas time. I don't know whose idea it was. I don't know who came up with the idea. But I was actually wanting to get all of our leadership up here, and thank God that we're not going to do this. But I was actually wanting all of our leaders, all of our department heads to come up here, and we were going to do the 12 days of Christmas for you. But we tried that last Wednesday night in the Bible class, and it didn't fly very high, so I quickly cut that out of the program. But this year, what our church has done for us, and I'm just going to tell you, church, we appreciate you very much. Thank you for letting us be your pastor. This year, the church has done something different for us at Christmas time. Starting on the 14th, I think it was, or the 12th or 13th, somewhere in there, they come in and we got a note and a little package at our door last Wednesday night as we came in from church. And we were like, what's this? And as we opened it up, we found a little letter in there subscribed to us. And the note said this: beginning tonight, every day from now to Christmas, you will find a gift at your door. Counting down the 12 days of Christmas, yesterday we got 4 calling birds. I wish those things would shut up because they keep calling all the time. But how awesome that is that you think of us that way, that you count down the days of Christ's birth. Just to do that, it's always funny because now when we get home, and you're spoiling us, you know that. Whenever we get to the house, Nancy runs up there and says, you know, what do we have? So now it's like a race between her and Francis, and they're going to kill each other. But I thank you for allowing us to be your pastor and for allowing us to share the gospel with you. I thank you for staying behind us and standing with us through the good times and through the bad times. That's what it is about being a family, is you're there. Through thick and thin, through the lows and the highs, you're there. We want to say thank you, Faith Alive Church, for allowing us to be your pastor for the last 6 years. We're hoping that there's another 26 years involved in this long-term relationship. I don't know what God has in store, but I know it's great. And I wanted to see the awesomeness of who you are really come about this year. I do want to ask Gary and April, would you stand please, just so people can acknowledge you. This is our church, Children's Church pastors. Frank and Tanya Hager, would you come to the front please? I know Frank's saying no, but come on, it don't matter how you dress, come on. We've seen you worse than that, so. And I won't say when, but that's okay. These are our TL4C Teens Living for Christ youth pastors getting ready to shed a new thing in blocks. Thank them very much for their hard work. These two are the hardest working people that God has sent us, and I'm not saying that to discount anybody else. But these guys do things behind the scenes that you'll never see. And that truly is a mark of Christ in their life. Because before, they wouldn't have. Would you? Wouldn't even thought about it. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
We'd like to thank, we couldn't have done anything without Kenny Sayer and Narissa and Cindy Makey and Robert and Tracy and Ron for all their help and support. They stand behind us in everything.
Amen. And you see, every time I get anything handed to me, that's what I do. It's you, the church, that makes this thing go, not the pastor. All we do is we're just here to oversee and to see that you get the thing in you, out of you. We want you to deliver this Christmas the gift that God has within you into this church, into this community, into this area, so that we can see the ministry of God fulfilled in this place. That's what we're about. At this time, I want you to stand with me if there's no further things that we need to do. I want you to stand with me. I want to say a prayer blessing over you and your house. I do have an announcement. The WM department of our church, which is the Women's Ministries Department, is having their annual Christmas party at 5 tonight at Poblenos. All are invited?
Yes.
Okay. If you want to come, you haven't got an invitation yet, you're invited. This is your invitation. Speak to Sister Tammy over here. She is our women's director, and she can give you the details on that. We also have, as you leave, the board, not the church, and not the pastor this year, but the board has some gifts for you as you leave, and they will be handing those out to you as you go out. Let's pray. I'm going to pray a special blessing over you this Christmas. Is that okay? Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Father, we ask your hand of blessing upon this congregation this morning. We thank you, Lord, for your gift, Lord, of salvation. We thank you, Lord, for everything else, God, that you give us. We're asking you, Lord, today, Lord, for a special gift, Lord, of peace upon this congregation this year at Christmas. Father, Lord, I'm asking you, God, that you let joy, Father, befall each individual under the sound of my voice this Christmas. And Father, Lord, as we go, Lord, let us have the gift of family and friends, Lord, gathered together, Lord, to celebrate the true meaning of Christmas. And Father, Lord, as we go from this place, we're asking your hand of protection upon us. Lord, we're asking this year, this coming year, Father, that it be our best year. Father, Lord, let finances and health and all the other things, God, spiritual growth, Lord, take place in our lives this coming year like we've never seen before. Because, Father, we know you're coming soon. Father, Lord, we ask you, God, that we all be ready at that appointed time. Father, right now we're asking your blessing upon this congregation. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.